Psalm 53 of Exposition on the Book of Psalms, Volume 3. Exposition on the Book of Psalms, Volume 3, Psalms 53-75, by Saint Augustine of Hippo. Section 1, Psalm 53. Psalm 53, Exposition. Of this psalm we undertake a treat with you, as far as the Lord supplieth us. A brother biddeth us that we may have the will, and prayeth that we may have the power. If anything in haste perchance I shall have passed over, he will supply it in you, that even to us deigneth to give what we shall be enabled to say. The title of it is, At the End, for Maleth, Understanding to David himself. For Maleth, as we find in interpretations of Hebrew names, seemeth to say, for one travailing, or in pain. But who there is in this world that travaileth and is in pain? The faithful acknowledge, because thereof they are. Christ here travaileth, Christ here is in pain. The head is above, the members below. For one not travailing nor in pain would not say, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? Him with whom when persecuting he was travailing, being converted, he made travail. For he also was himself afterwards enlightened, and grafted on those members which he used to persecute. Being pregnant with the same love, he said, My little children, of whom again I travail, until Christ be formed in you. For the members therefore of Christ, for his body, which is the church, for that same one man, that is, for that very unity, whereof the head is above, this psalm is sung. But this man groaneth, and travaileth, and is in pain. Wherefore, or amid whom, except that he hath received and learned from his head, who saith, Iniquity shall abound, and the love of many shall wax cold? But if iniquity shall abound, and the love of many shall wax cold, who shall remain to travail? It followeth, He that shall have persevered unto the end, the same shall be saved. How would it be a great thing to persevere, unless amid molestations and temptations and distractions and scandals, men had to persevere? For no one is bid to endure good things. But forasmuch as for such an one it is said, and forasmuch as for such an one it is sung, let us see what it is. For his sake are rebuked here the men, amid whom he groaneth, amid whom he is in pain, and the consolation of one in pain and travail at the end of the psalm is drawn forth and expressed. Who are they, then, amid whom we travail and groan? If in the body of Christ we are, if under him, the head we live, if amongst his members we are counted. Who they are, hear ye. 2. Verse 1. The unwise man hath said in his heart, There is no God. Such sort is it of men, amid whom is pained and groaneth the body of Christ. If such is this sort of men, of not many do we travail. As far as seemeth to occur to our thoughts, very few there are, and a difficult thing it is to meet with a man that saith in his heart, There is no God. Nevertheless, so few there are, that fearing amid the many to say this, in their heart they say it, for that with mouth to say it they dare not. Not much, then, is that which we are bid to endure, hardly is it found. Uncommon is that sort of men that say in their heart there is no God. But, if it be examined in another sense, is not that found to be in more men, which we suppose to be in men few and uncommon, and almost in none? Let them come forth into the midst that live evil lives. Let us look into the doings of profligate, daring, and wicked men, of whom there is a great multitude, who foster day by day their sins, who, their acts having been changed into habit, have even lost sense of shame. This is so great a multitude of men, that the body of Christ, set amid them, scarce dareth to censure that which it is not constrained to commit, and deemeth it a great matter for itself that the integrity of innocence be preserved in not doing that which now by habit, either it doth not dare to blame, or if it shall have dared, more readily there breaketh out the censure and recrimination of them that live evil lives, than the free voice of them that live good lives. And those men are such as say in their heart, There is no God. Such men I am confuting. Whence confuting? that their doings please God, they judge. He doth not therefore affirm, some say, but the unwise man hath said in his heart there is no God. Which men do so far believe there is a God, that the same God they judge with what they do to be pleased. But if thou being wise dost perceive, how the unwise man hath said in his heart there is no God, if thou give heed, if thou understand, if thou examine, he that thinketh that evil doings please God, him he doth not think to be God. For if God is, just he is. If just he is, injustice displeaseth him, iniquity displeaseth. But thou, when thou thinkest that iniquity pleaseth him, dost deny God. For if God is one whom iniquity displeaseth, but to thee God seemeth not to be one whom iniquity displeaseth, and there is no God but one whom iniquity displeaseth, when thou sayest in thy heart, God doth countenance my iniquities, nothing else thou sayest then, there is no God. 3. Let us advert also to that sense which concerning Christ our Lord himself, our head himself, doth present itself. For when himself in form of a servant appeared on earth, they that crucified him said, he is not God. Because Son of God he was, truly God he was. But they that are corrupted and have become abominable said, what? He is not God, let us slay him, he is not God. Thou hast the voice of these very men in the book of wisdom. For after there had gone before the verse, the unwise man hath said in his heart, there is no God. As if reasons were required, why the unwise man could say this, he hath subjoined. Verse 2, corrupted they are, and abominable have become in their iniquities. Hear ye those corrupted men, for they have said with themselves, not rightly thinking. Corruption beginneth with evil belief, thence it proceedeth to depraved morals, thence to the most flagrant iniquities. These are the grades. But what with themselves said they, thinking not rightly? A small thing, and with tediousness is our life. From this evil belief followeth that which also the apostle hath spoken of. Let us eat and drink, for tomorrow we shall die. But in the former passage, more diffusely luxury itself is described. Let us crown us with roses, before they be withered. In every place let us leave the tokens of our gladness. After the more diffuse description of that luxury, what followeth? Let us slay the poor just man. This is therefore saying, he is not God. Soft words they seemed but now to say, let us crown us with roses before they be withered. What more delicate, what more soft? Wouldst thou expect out of this softness crosses, swords? Wonder not, soft are even the roots of brambles. If anyone handle them, he is not pricked. But that wherewith thou shalt be pricked from thence hath birth. Corrupted therefore are those men, and abominable have become in their iniquities. The unwise man hath said in his heart, he is not God. If Son of God he is, let him come down from the cross. Behold them openly saying, he is not God. 4. But in what manner amid them groaneth the body of Christ? There have groaned amid them apostles that then were, and disciples of Christ. To us in what respect do they belong? In what manner amid them do we travail? Still there are that say Christ is not God. This say the heathens that have remained. This very thing say the Jews themselves, who for the testimony of their confusion everywhere have been diffused. This say also many heretics. For even the Arians have said he is not God. Eunomians have said he is not God. Add to this, brethren, that even they of whom a little before I have spoken, who live evil lives, do nothing else say than, he is not God. For when we say to them that Christ is to come a judge to the judgment, which things say the scriptures that deceive not? Yet they rather lending an ear to the serpent, suggesting, thou shalt not die the death, which he had said in paradise, contrary to the truth of God, determining and saying, thou shalt die the death, so do evil things, that they say to themselves, Christ shall come, and shall give indulgence to all. So then lying is he that hath said, He shall sever unrighteous men to the left hand, shall sever just men to the right hand. To just men shall say, Come, ye blessed of my Father, receive the kingdom which hath been prepared for you from the foundation of the world. To ungodly men shall say, Go ye into fire everlasting, which hath been prepared for the devil and his angels. How then to all shall he give indulgence? How shall he no one condemn? Therefore he lieth. This is to say, he is not God. See then that thou perchance lie not, for thou art a man, he God. For God is true, but every man a liar. But what say I of these men, O body of Christ? Sever thyself from them meanwhile in heart and life. Neither imitate, nor keep company, nor assent, nor approve them, but more, even rebuke them. For why dost thou give heed to them that say these words? Corrupted they are, and abominable have become in their iniquities. There is not one that doeth good. 5. Verse 3. The Lord from heaven hath looked forth upon the sons of men, that he might see if there is one understanding and seeking after God. What is this? Corrupted they are, and abominable have become, all these that say there is no God? And what, did it escape God that there were become such? Or indeed to us would their inward thought be opened, except by him it were told. If then he understood, if then he knew, what is this which hath been said, that from heaven he hath looked forth upon the sons of men, that he might see if there is one understanding in seeking after God? For of one inquiring the words are, of one not knowing. God from heaven hath looked forth upon the sons of men, that he might see if there is one understanding or seeking after God. And as though he had found what he sought by looking upon, and by looking down from heaven, he giveth sentence. Verse 4, All men have gone aside, together useless they have become. There is not one that doeth good, not so much as one. Two questions arise somewhat difficult. For if God looketh out from heaven, in order that he may see if there is one understanding or seeking after God, there stealeth upon an unwise man the thought that God knoweth not all things. This is one question. What is the other? If there is not one that doeth good, is not so much as one, who is he that travaileth amid bad men? The former question then is solved as followeth. Oft times the scripture speaketh in such manner that what by the gift of God a creature doth, God is said to do. So that, for instance, when thou hast pity upon a poor man, because by the gift of God thou art acting, God hath pity. When thou acknowledgest who thou art, because by aid of him giving light thou art acting, if thou art such an one as to say, Thou shalt light my lamp, O Lord my God, thou shalt lighten my darkness. That which by aid of him giving and doing thou hast acknowledged, he doth acknowledge. For whence is, The Lord your God proveth you, that he may know if ye love him. What is, that he may know? That by his gift he may make you know. So then here also, God from heaven hath looked forth upon the sons of men, that he might see if there is one understanding or seeking after God. Be he present himself, and grant us that what he hath made our heart to conceive, he may also make it to bring forth. The apostle saith, But we not the spirit of this world have received, but the spirit which is of God, that we may know what things by God have been given to us. By this spirit then, whereby we understand what things by God have been given to us, we distinguish between ourselves and them to whom these things have not been given, and from ourselves we understand them. For if we perceive that we could not have had any good thing except by the giving and bestowing of him from whom are all good things, at the same time we see that no such thing can they have to whom God hath not given. This distinguishing in us is of the Spirit of God, and by the means whereby we see this, God seeth, because this thing God doeth, that we should see. For hence has been said the following also, For the Spirit searcheth all things, even the depth of God. Not because he searcheth that knoweth all things, but because to thee hath been given the Spirit, which maketh thee also to search. And that which by his own gift thou doest, he is said to do, because without him thou wouldest not do it. Therefore God is said to do when thou doest. By the gift of the Spirit of sons, they to whom hath been given the Spirit of God look out upon the sons of men, that they may see if there is one understanding or seeking after God. But because that by the gift of God, and by the Spirit of God they do it, this God is said to do, as it were to look forth and see. But wherefore from heaven, if this is done by men? Because, saith the apostle, but our conversation is in the heavens. For whence doest thou this that thou mayest see? Whence lookest forth that thou mayest perceive? Is it not in heart? If in heart thou doest this, Christian, see whether it is above thou hast thy heart. If above thou hast thy heart, from heaven upon earth thou art looking forth. And because this by the gift of God thou doest, God from heaven is looking forth upon the sons of men. The former question, then, according to our measure, thus hath been solved. 6. What is that which looking forth we acknowledge? What is that which looking forth God acknowledgeth? What, because here he giveth it, doth he acknowledge? Hear what it is. That all have gone aside, together useless they have become. There is not one that doeth good, there is not so much as one. What then is that other question, but the same whereof a little before I have made mention? If there is not one that doeth good, is not so much as one, no one remaineth to groan amid evil men. Stay, saith the Lord, do not hastily give judgment. I have given to men to do well, but of me, he saith, not of themselves. For of themselves evil they are, sons of men they are when they do evil, when well, my sons. For this thing God doth, out of sons of men he maketh sons of God, because out of son of God he hath made son of man. See what this participation is. There hath been promised to us a participation of divinity. He lieth that has promised, if he is not first made partaker of mortality. For the Son of God hath been made partaker of mortality, in order that mortal man may be made partaker of divinity. He hath promised that his good is to be shared with thee. First with thee hath shared thy evil. He that to thee hath promised divinity sheweth in thee love. Therefore take away that men are sons of God. There remaineth that they are sons of men. There is none that doeth good, is not so much as one. 7. Verse 4. Shall not all know that work iniquity, that devour my people for the food of bread? Shall they not know? Shall it not to them be shewn? Say, Menas, speak by the voice of one travailing and grieving, for thy people is devoured for the food of bread. There is therefore here a people of God that is being devoured. Nay, there is not one that doeth good, there is not so much as one. We reply by the rule above. But this people that is devoured, this people that suffereth evil men, this that groaneth and travaileth amid evil men, now out of sons of men have been made sons of God, therefore are they devoured. For the counsel of the needy man thou hast confounded, because the Lord is his hope. For oft times, in order that the people of God may be devoured, this very thing in it is despised, that it is the people of God. I will pillage, he saith, and despoil. If he is a Christian, what will he do to me? There speaketh for him he that speaketh for one travailing, and he doth menace them that are devouring, saying, shall not all know that work iniquity? For even he that was seeing a thief and was consenting with him, and with the adulterers was setting his portion, sitting against his brother was detracting, and against his mother's son was setting a stumbling block, hath said in his heart, there is no God. Therefore this to him is said, these things thou hast done, and I kept silence. Thou hast imagined iniquity, that I shall be like thee. That is, I shall not be God, if I shall be like thee. But what followeth? I will convince thee, and will set thee before thy face. So here also, I will convince thee and set thee before thy face. Thou wilt not now know so as thou shouldest be displeasing to thyself. Thou shalt know so as thou mayest mourn. For God cannot but shew to the unrighteous their iniquity. If he is not to shew, who will they be that are to say, what hath profited us pride, and what hath boasting of riches bestowed upon us? For then shall they know that now will not know. Shall not all know that work iniquity, that devour my people for the food of bread? Why hath he added, for the food of bread? As it were as bread, they eat my people. For all other things which we eat, we can eat now these, now those. Not always this vegetable, not always this flesh, not always these apples, but always bread. What is then, devour my people for the food of bread? Without intermission, without cessation, they devour, that devour my people for the food of bread. 8. On God they have not called. He is comforting the man that groaneth, and chiefly by an admonition, lest by imitating evil men, who ofttimes prosper, they delight in evil doing. There is kept for thee that which to thee hath been promised. Their hope is present, thine is future, but theirs is transient, thine sure, theirs false, thine true. For they, upon God, have not called. Do not daily such men ask of God? They do not ask of God. Give heed, if I am able to say this by the aid of God himself. God gratuitously will have himself to be worshipped, gratuitously will have himself to be loved, that is, chastely to be loved. Not himself to be loved for the reason that he giveth anything besides himself, but because he giveth himself. He then that calleth upon God in order that he may be made rich, on God doth not call. For upon that he calleth which to himself, he willeth to come. For what is to call upon, but to call upon himself? Unto himself therefore to call is the meaning of to call upon. For when thou sayest, O God, give me riches, thou wilt not that God himself should come to thee, but wilt that riches should come to thee. What thou wilt to thee should come, upon the same thou callest. But if upon God thou wast calling, to thee he would himself come, himself would be thy riches. But now thou wouldest have coffer full and conscience void. God filleth not coffer, but breast. What do outward riches profit thee, if inward need presseth thee? Therefore those men that for the sake of worldly comforts, that for the sake of earthly good things, that for the sake of present life and earthly felicity, call upon God, do not call upon God. 9. For this reason, what followeth concerning them? Verse 5. There have they feared with fear, where there was no fear. For is there fear if a man lose riches? There is no fear there, and yet in that case men are afraid. But if a man lose wisdom, truly there is fear, and in that case he is not afraid. Hear, distinguish, understand such men. There is entrusted to some one or other a bag, he will not give it back. For his own he counteth it. He thinketh not that it can be demanded back. Already for his own he will keep it, he refuseth to give it back. Let him observe what he feareth to lose, and what he will not have. Into jeopardy come money and fidelity. Whichever is the more valuable, therein the heavier loss is to be feared. But thou, that thou mayest keep gold, dost lose fidelity. With heavier loss thou art stricken, and thou of thy gain hast rejoiced. In that case thou hast feared with fear, where was no fear. Give back the money. Too little, I say, give back. Lose the money, lest thou lose fidelity. Thou hast feared to give back money, and hast willed to lose fidelity. The martyrs took not away property of other persons, but even their own they despised, that they might not lose fidelity. And it was too little to lose money, when they were proscribed. They took also their life when they suffered. They lost life, in order that unto everlasting life they might find it. Therefore there they feared, where they ought to have been afraid. But they that of Christ have said he is not God, have there feared where was no fear. For they said, if we shall have let him go, there will come the Romans, and will take away from us both place and kingdom. O folly and imprudence, saying in its heart, he is not God. Thou hast feared to lose earth, thou hast lost heaven. Thou hast feared lest there should come the Romans, and take away from thee place and kingdom. Could they take away from thee God? What then remaineth? What but that thou confess, that thou hast willed to keep, and by keeping ill hast lost? For thou hast lost both place and nation by slaying Christ. For ye did will rather to slay Christ than to lose place, and ye have lost place and nation and Christ. In fearing they have slain Christ. But wherefore this? For God hath scattered the bones of them that please men. Willing to please men, they feared to lose their place. But Christ himself, of whom they said, he is not God, willed rather to displease such men as they were. Sons of men, not sons of God, he willed rather to displease. Thence were scattered their bones, his bones no one hath broken. They were confounded, for God hath despised them. In very deed, brethren, as far as regardeth them, great confusion hath come to them. In the place where they crucified the Lord, whom for this cause they crucified, that they might not lose both place and nation, the Jews are not. God, therefore, hath despised them, and yet in despising he warned them to be converted. Let them now confess Christ, and say, he is God, of whom they said, he is not God. Let them return to the inheritance of their fathers, to the inheritance of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob. Let them possess with these very persons life eternal, though they have lost life temporal. Wherefore this? Because out of sons of men have been made sons of God. For so long as they remain, and will not, there is not one that doeth good, there is not so much as one. They were confounded, for God hath despised them. And as though to these very persons he returned, he saith, verse 6, who shall give out of Sion salvation to Israel? O ye fools, ye revile, insult, buffet, besmear with spittings, with thorns ye crown, upon the cross ye lift up. Whom? Who shall give out of Sion salvation to Israel? Shall not that same of whom ye have said he is not God? In God's turning away the captivity of his people. For there turneth away the captivity of his people, no one but he that hath willed to be a captive in your own hands. But what men shall understand this thing? Jacob shall exult, and Israel shall rejoice. Israel, the true Jacob, and the true Israel, that younger to whom the elder was servant, shall himself exult, for he shall himself understand. End of Psalm 53.
Psalm 54, Part 1 of Expositions on the Book of Psalms, Volume 3. Exposition on the Book of Psalms, Volume 3, Psalms 53-75, by Saint Augustine of Hippo. 1. The title of this psalm hath fruit in the prolixity thereof, if it be understood. And because the psalm is short, let us make up by tarrying over the title, our not having to tarry over the psalm. For upon this dependeth every verse which is sung. If any one, therefore, observe that which on the front of the house is fixed, secure he will enter, and when he shall have entered he will not err. For this on the post itself is prominently marked, namely, in what manner within he may not be in error. The title thereof standeth thus, At the end, in hymns, understanding to David himself, when there came the Ziphites, and said to Saul, Behold, is not David hidden with us? That Saul was persecutor of the holy man David, very well we know, that Saul was bearing the figure of a temporal kingdom, not to life but to death belonging. This also to your love we remember to have imparted. And also that David himself was bearing the figure of Christ, or the body of Christ. Ye ought both to know and to call to mind, ye that have already learned. What then of the Ziphites? There was a certain village, Ziph, whereof the inhabitants were Ziphites, in whose country David had hidden himself, when Saul would find and slay him. These Ziphites, then, when they had learned this, betrayed him to the king, his persecutor, saying, Behold, is not David hidden within us? Of no good to them indeed was their betrayal, and to David himself of no harm, for their evil disposition was shown. But Saul was not even after their betrayal, but Saul, not even after their betrayal, could seize David, but rather in a certain cave in that very country, when into his hands Saul had been given to slay, David spared him, and that which he had in his power he did not. But the other was seeking to do that which he had not in his power. Let them that have been Ziphites take heed. Let us see those whom to us the psalm presenteth to be understood by the occasion of those same men. 2. If we inquire then what word is translated Ziphites, we find men flourishing. Flourishing then were certain enemies to holy David, flourishing before him, hiding. We may find them in mankind, if we are willing to understand the psalm. Let us find here at first David hiding, and we shall find his adversaries flourishing. Observe David hiding. For ye are dead, saith the apostle to the members of Christ, and your life is hid with Christ in God. These men, therefore, that are hiding, when shall they be flourishing? When Christ, he saith, your life shall have appeared, then ye also with him shall appear in glory. When these men shall be flourishing, then shall be those Ziphites withering. For observe to what flower their glory is compared. Flesh is grass, and the honor of flesh as the flower of grass. What is the end? The grass hath withered, and the flower hath fallen off. Where then shall be David? See what followeth, but the word of the Lord abideth for ever. These, therefore, are two sorts of men, which ye ought both to distinguish and to choose one of them. For what doth it profit thee to know, if thou art slow to choose? And indeed, now the power of choosing lieth near thee. There shall come a time when thou shalt no more have the power of choosing, when no longer God shall defer the sentence of judgment. For who are these flourishing Ziphites, except that body of Doug the Edomite, of whom already we have spoken to your love a few days since, of whom it was said, Behold, a man that hath not set God for his helper, but hath trusted in the multitude of his riches, and hath prevailed in his vanity. These are the flourishing sons of the world, of whom but now ye have heard from the gospel, that in their own generation they are more crafty than the children of light. For they too seem to look forward into the future, whereto they know not whether they may come. Ye have heard what that steward did to his master, making for himself a store out of his master's property, and bestowing it upon his debtors, in order that when he should be removed from his stewardship, he might be received by them. And though he defrauded his master, yet his master praised his wit, not heeding his own loss, but his ingenuity. How much more ought we, himself, our Lord Jesus Christ, admonishing, to make to ourselves friends of the mammon of iniquity? For mammon is interpreted riches. But our riches are in that place, where is our house eternal in the heavens. Again, money temporal they call riches, who except for a time cannot flourish, nor for everlasting from these do will to make themselves friends, because true riches they know not. These riches, then, to be riches, iniquity alone doth count, flourishing as it does for a time like grass. These are the Ziphites, enemies of God, flourishing in the world. 3. These men sometimes are observed of the weak sons of light, and their feet totter, when they have seen evil men in felicity to flourish, and they say to themselves, Of what profit to me is innocence? What doth it advantage me that I serve God, that I keep his commandments, that I oppress no one, from no one plunder any thing, hurt no one, that what I can I bestow? Behold, all these things I do, and they flourish, I toil. But why? Wouldst thou also wish to be a Ziphite? They flourish in the world, wither in judgment, and after withering into fire everlasting shall be cast. Wouldst thou also choose this? Art thou ignorant of what he hath promised thee, who to thee hath come, what in himself there he displayed? If the flower of the Ziphites were to be desired, would not himself thy Lord also in this world have flourished? Or indeed was there wanting to him the power to flourish? Nay, but here he chose rather amid the Ziphites to hide, and to say to Pontius Pilate, as if to one being himself also a flower of the Ziphites, and in suspicion about his kingdom, My kingdom is not of this world. Therefore here he was hidden, and all good men are hidden here, because their good is within. It is concealed. In the heart it is, where is faith, where charity, where hope, where their treasure is. Do these good things appear in the world? Both these good things are hidden, and the reward of these good things is hidden. But truly the dignity of the world is white in what manner? It is bright for a time. Will it always be bright? It is grass in the winter, until the summer it is green. Let not that thing before be done in the mind, which in another psalm we light on. For there a certain one confesseth that he almost fell himself, and that his step slipped walking in the way of God, while he was beholding the flower, as it were, and felicity of the ungodly. And after that he understood what God was reserving for the wicked at the last, and what he that cannot deceive was promising to the just toiling. Returning thanks for this understanding, he saith, How good is the God of Israel to the right in heart! Wherefore dost thou say this? But my own feet, he saith, were almost moved. For what reason? Because I was jealous toward sinners, beholding the peace of sinners. But his steps were strengthened after that he understood at the last. For that which in the same psalm, a little after, he saith, On this account labor is before me is this. A great question to me hath arisen in my heart, wherefore men do evil, and in the world flourish, but many men do well, and in this world do labor. While this great question was before my eyes, and laborious to be investigated, there is labor, he saith, before me, until I enter into the sanctuary of God, and understand at the last things. What are these last things? What but these things which we know already in the gospel to have been foretold? For when the Son of Man shall be come, there shall be gathered before him all nations, and he shall separate them as a shepherd divideth the sheep from the goats. The sheep he shall set on the right hand, the goats on the left. Behold, then shall these Ziphites be separated. Flame followeth separation. Where is the flower of them that now on the left hand shall stand? Shall they not then groan? Shall they not then be racked with a too late penitence, and say, Of what profit to us hath been pride, and what hath boasting of riches bestowed upon us? All these things have passed away like a shadow, O ye Ziphites, on the left hand standing. Too late it repenteth you in the shadow to have flourished. Wherefore did you not acknowledge David, whose hiding among you ye betrayed? For then, if ye had been amended, that sorrow would not have been without fruit. For there is a sorrow with fruit, there is one without fruit. A sorrow with fruit is now, when thyself thou accusest, when in thyself thou censurest thy evil customs. When them censured thou dost persecute, persecuted thou shuttest them out. And after these have been shut out, thou art changed, putting off from thyself the old man, and putting on the new, choosing rather the reproach of Christ than the flower of the Ziphites. Moreover, if while holding thy good in secret and hiding amid Ziphites, holding in secret also the promise of thy reward, there shall have been chance to thee any high place of the world, be not lifted up. For if I lift it up, thou wilt fall upon the flower of the Ziphites. For so it was with a certain holy woman, Esther, amid the then people of the Jews. Though she was the wife of a foreign king, she so shared the danger of her countrymen, that she interceded with the king for her countrymen. She began to pray, and in the very prayer she confessed that all these royal deckings were to her but as the cloth of a menstruous woman. If these things women can do, cannot men? And if these things a Jewish woman could do, shall not the Christian church be able? This, therefore, I would say to your love. If riches flow in, set not your heart upon them. Though they abound, and there follow thee the prosperity of the world, trust not thou in the sea, though it smile on thee. If riches flow in, if they abound, trample them, and depend upon thy God. For when them beneath thee thou shalt have put, and put on him shalt have depended, when they shall have been taken away, thou wilt not fall. Let not perchance be thy thought evil and unchristian, that be done in thee which is spoken of in another psalm, when there had been made mention of the flower of these Ziphites. Too deep, he saith, have become thy thoughts. I say, it is said, too deep have become thy thoughts. A man unwise shall not know, and a fool shall not understand these things. Shall not understand what? When there shall rise up sinners like grass, and all they that work iniquity shall have beheld, that they perish for ever and ever. They have been delighted with the flower of evil men. They have said with themselves, Behold, evil men flourish. I suppose evil men God doth love. And being delighted with the temporal flower of iniquity, they turned themselves to iniquity, so that they perished. Not for a time, as they flourish, but for ever and ever. Whence this? Because a man unwise shall not know, and a fool shall not understand these things, not entering into the sanctuary of God, in order to understand at the last things. And because somewhat difficult is this understanding, from thence beginneth this psalm, namely, how David was hiding among the Ziphites, and was not delighted with the flower of the Ziphites, but chose rather amid them humility, in order that he might have with God hidden glory. What then to him is there being ascribed in this title? At the end in hymns, that is, in praises. In what praises? The Lord hath given, the Lord hath taken away. As it hath pleased the Lord, so hath been done. Be the name of the Lord blessed. Withered in a manner did he seem in the loss of all his substance? God forbid. Leaves had fallen, the root was living. Therefore, at the end in hymns, what is understanding to David himself? Understanding against this. A man unwise shall not know, and a fool shall not understand these things. Understanding to David himself, when there came the Ziphites and said to Saul, Behold, is David hidden with us? And be he hidden with you, so long as he flourish, not like you. Hear, therefore, the voice of him. 4. Verse 1. O God, in thy name make me safe, and in thy virtue judge me. Let the church say this, hiding amid the Ziphites. Let the body, Christian, say this, keeping secret the good of its morals, expecting in secret the reward of its merits. Let it say this, O God, in thy name make me safe, and in thy virtue judge me. Thou hast come, O Christ, humble thou hast appeared, despised thou hast been, scourged hast been, crucified hast been, slain hast been, but on the third day hast risen, on the 40th day into heaven hast ascended. Thou sittest at the right hand of the Father, and no one seeth. Thy Spirit thence thou hast sent, which men the praise of that very humility of thine throughout the world and nations they have preached. Thy name I see to excel among mankind, but nevertheless, as weak to us hast thou been preached. For not even did that teacher of the Gentiles say, that among us he knew anything, save Christ Jesus and him crucified, in order that of him we might choose the reproach, rather than the glory of the flourishing Ziphites. Nevertheless of him he saith what? Although he died of weakness, yet he liveth of the power of God. He came then that he might die of weakness. He is to come that he may judge in the power of God. but through the weakness of the cross his name hath been illustrious. Whosoever shall not have believed upon the name made illustrious through weakness shall stand in awe at the judge, when he shall have come in power. But lest he hath that once was weak, when he shall have come strong, with that fan send us to the left hand, may he save us in his name, and judge us in his virtue. For who so rash as to have desired this, as to say to God, for instance, judge me? Is it not wont to be said to men for a curse, God judge thee? So evidently it is a curse, if he judge thee in his virtue, and shall not have saved thee in his name. But when in name precedent he shall have saved thee, to thy health in virtue consequent he shall judge. Be thou without care, that judgment shall not to thee be punishment, but dividing. For in a certain psalm thus is said, judge me, O God, and divide my cause from the nation unholy. What is judge me? Divide me from the Ziphites, amid whom I lie hid. I have endured their flower. May there now come also my flowering. And their flower indeed hath been temporary, and the grass withering it hath fallen off. But my flower shall be what? They that are planted in the house of the Lord, in the courts of the house of our God, shall flourish. There remaineth therefore to us also flower, but that which falleth not, like the leaf of that tree planted beside waters, whereof is said, and his leaf shall not fall off. O God, therefore in thy name make me safe, and in thy virtue judge me. End of Psalm 54, Part 1. Psalm 54, Part 2 of Expositions on the Book of Psalms, Volume 3, Mount Vernon, Ohio. Expositions on the Book of Psalms, Volume 3, Psalms 53-75, by Saint Augustine of Hippo. Chapter 3. 5. Verse 2. O God, hearken to my prayer. In thy ears receive the words of my mouth. Let the words of my mouth reach thine ears, because it is not the flower of the Ziphites that I desire of thee. In thy ears receive the words of my mouth. Do thou receive, for to the Ziphites, even if there sound my prayer, they hear not, because they understand not. In temporal things, to wit, they rejoice. Good things everlasting to desire, they know not how. To thee may my prayer attain, driven forth and darted out from the desire of thy eternal blessings. To thy ear I send it forth, aid it that it may reach, lest it fall short in the middle of the way, and fainting, as it were, it fall down. But even if there result not to me now the good things which I ask, I am secured nevertheless that hereafter they will come. For even in the case of transgressions a certain man is said to have asked of God, and not to have been hearkened to for his good. For privations of this world had inspired him to prayer, and being set in temporal tribulations, he had wished that temporal tribulations should pass away, and there should return the flower of grass. And he saith, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? The very voice of Christ it is, but for his members' sake. The words, he saith, of my transgressions I have cried to thee throughout the day, and thou hast not hearkened, and by night, and not for the sake of folly to me. That is, and by night I have cried, and thou hast not hearkened, and nevertheless in this very thing that thou hast not hearkened, it is not for the sake of folly to me that thou hast not hearkened, but rather for the sake of wisdom that thou hast not hearkened, that I might perceive what of thee I ought to ask. For those things I was asking, which to my cost perchance I should have received. Thou askest riches, O man. How many have been overset through their riches? Whence knowest thou whether to thee riches may profit? Have not more men more safely been in obscurity, having become rich men, so soon as they have begun to blaze forth, they have been a prey to the stronger. How much better they would have been, how much better they would have lain concealed, how much better they would have been unknown, than have begun to be inquired after not for the sake of what they were, but for the sake of what they had. In these temporal things, therefore, brethren, we admonish and exhort you in the Lord, that ye ask not anything as if it were a thing settled, but that which God knoweth to be expedient for you. For what is expedient for you, ye know not at all. Sometimes that which ye think to be for you is against you, and that which ye think to be against you is for you. For sick ye are, do not dictate to the physician the medicines he may choose to set beside you. If the teacher of the Gentiles, Paul the Apostle, saith, For what we should pray for as we ought, we know not, how much more we? Who, nevertheless, when he seemed to himself pray wisely, namely, that from him should be taken away the thorn of the flesh, the angel of Satan, that did buffet him, in order that he might not in the greatness of the revelations be lifted up, heard from the Lord what? Was that done which he wished? Nay, in order to that being done which was expedient. He heard from the Lord, I say what? Thrice he saith, I besought the Lord that he would take it from me, and he said to me, My grace sufficeth for thee. For virtue in weakness is made perfect. Salve to the wound I have applied. When I applied it, I know. When it should be taken away, I know. Let not a sick man draw back from the hands of the physician. Let him not give advice to the physician. So it is with all these things temporal. There are tribulations. If well thou worshippest God, thou wilt know that he knoweth what is expedient for each man. There are prosperities. Take the more heed, lest these same corrupt thy soul, so that it withdraw from him that hath given these things. Therefore this man understanding saith what? O God, hearken to my prayer. In thy ears receive the words of my mouth. 6. Verse 3. For aliens have risen up against me. What aliens? Was not David himself a Jew of the tribe of Judah? But the very place Ziph belonged to the tribe of Judah, it was of the Jews. How then aliens? Not in city, not in tribe, not in kindred, but in flower. For wilt thou know of those aliens? In another psalm, alien sons may have been called, whose mouth hath spoken vanity, and their right hand is a right hand of iniquity. And he enumerateth the flower of the Ziphites, of whom their sons are like young plants established in their youth, their daughters disposed and decked like the similitude of a temple, their garners full, breaking forth from this unto this, their sheep fruitful, multiplying in their goings out, their oxen fat, there is no falling of the enclosure, nor going forth, nor cry in their streets. But see the Ziphites, see them for a time flourishing. Blessed they have called the people to whom these things are, with reason alien sons. Thou amid the Ziphites hiding saidst what? Blessed the people whereof the Lord is its God. Out of this affection this prayer is being sent forth into the ears of the Lord, when it is said, In thy ears receive the words of my mouth, for aliens have risen up against me. 7. And mighty men have sought after my soul. For in a new manner, my brethren, they would destroy the race of holy men, and the race of them that abstain from hoping in this world, all that they have hope in this world. Certainly commingled they are, certainly together they live. Very much to one another are opposed these two sorts, the one of those that place no hope but in things secular, and in temporal felicity, and the other of those that do firmly place their hope in the Lord God. And though concordant are these Ziphites, do not much trust to their concord. Temptations are wanting. When there shall have come any temptation, so as that a person may be reproved for the flower of the world, I say not to thee he will quarrel with the bishop, but not even to the church herself will he draw near, lest there fall any part of the grass. Wherefore have I said these words, brethren? Because now gladly ye all hear in the name of Christ, and according as ye understand, so ye shout out at the word. Ye would not indeed shout at it unless ye understood. This is your understanding. this your understanding ought to be fruitful. But whether it is fruitful, temptation doth try. Lest suddenly, when ye said to be ours, through temptation ye be found aliens, and it be said, aliens have risen up against me, and mighty men have sought my soul. Be not that said which followeth. They have not set forth God before their face. For when will he set God before his face, before whose eyes there is not but the world? Namely, how he may have coin upon coin, how flocks may be increased, how barns may be filled, how it may be said to his soul, Thou hast many good things, be merry, feast, take thy fill. Doth he set before his face him, that unto one so boasting and so blooming with the flower of the Ziphites saith, Fool, that is, man not understanding, man unwise, this night shall be taken from thee thy soul, all these things which thou hast prepared, whose shall they be? They have not set forth God before their face. 8. Verse 4. For behold, God helpeth me. Even themselves know not themselves, amid whom I am hiding. But if they too were to set God before their face, they would find in what manner God helpeth me. For all holy men are helped by God, but within where no one seeth. For in like manner as the conscience of the ungodly men is a great punishment, so a great joy is the very conscience of godly men. For our glory is this, saith the apostle, the testimony of our conscience. In this doth glory that man within, not in the flower of the Ziphites without, that now saith, For behold, God helpeth me. Surely, though afar off are to be those things which he promiseth, this day have I a sweet and present help. Today in my heart's joy I find that without cause certain say, Who doth show to us good things? For there is signed upon us the light of thy countenance, O Lord. Thou hast put pleasantness into my heart. Not into my vineyard, not into my flock, not into my cask, not into my table, but into my heart. For behold, God helpeth me. How doth he help thee? And the Lord is the lifter up of my soul. 9. Verse 5. Turn away evil things unto mine enemies. So however green they are, so however they flourish, for the fire they are being reserved. In thy virtue destroy thou them. Because to wit they flourish now, because to wit they spring up like grass. Do not thou be a man unwise and foolish, so that by giving thought to these things thou perish for ever and ever. For turn thou away evil things unto mine enemies. For if thou shalt have a place in the body of David himself, in his virtue he will destroy them. These men flourish in the felicity of the world, perish in the virtue of God. Not in the same manner as they flourish do they also perish, for they flourish for a time, perish for everlasting, flourish in unreal good things, perish in real torments. In thy virtue destroy thou them whom in thy weakness thou hast endured. 10. Verse 6. Voluntarily I will sacrifice to thee. Who can even understand this good thing of the heart at another's speaking thereof, unless in himself he hath tasted it? What is voluntarily I will sacrifice to thee? Nevertheless I will say on, Let him receive that is able as he is able, let him believe that is not able, and pray that he may be able. For ought we, by any means, so to pass over this verse as not to commend it to you? I say to your love, my affection for it doth sufficiently invite me to speak something concerning it. And thanks I render to God, that with attention ye hear. But if I should observe you reluctant to hear, unwilling on this verse, I should hold my peace, and yet in my heart, as far as the Lord would deign to grant, I should not hold my peace. May there come then unto my tongue that which in heart hath been conceived. May there be drawn forth in word that which in mind is kept. Say as we are able, what is, voluntarily I will sacrifice to thee. For what sacrifice here shall I take, brethren? Or what worthily shall I offer to the Lord for his mercy? Victims shall I seek from flock of sheep, ram shall I select, for any bull in the herds shall I look out, frankincense indeed from the land of the Sabaeans shall I bring. What shall I do? What offer, except that whereof he speaketh? Sacrifices of praise shall honor me. Wherefore then voluntarily? Because truly I love that which I praise. I praise God, and in the selfsame praise I rejoice. In the praise of himself I rejoice, at whom being praised I blush not. For he is not praised in the same manner as by those who love the theatrical follies, is praised either by a charioteer, or a hunter, or actor of any kind, and by their praisers. Other praisers are invited, are exhorted to shout together, and when all have shouted, oft times if their favorite is overcome, they are all put to the blush. Not so is our God. Be he praised with the will, loved with charity. Let it be gratuitous that he is loved and that he is praised. What is gratuitous? Himself for the sake of himself, not for the sake of something else. For if thou praisest God in order that he may give thee something else, no longer freely dost thou love God. Thou wouldest blush if the wife for the sake of riches were to love thee, and perchance if poverty should befall thee, should begin to think of adultery. Seeing that before thou wouldst be loved by thy partner freely, wilt thou for anything else love God? What reward art thou to receive of God, O covetous man? Not earth for thee, but himself he keepeth, who made heaven and earth. Voluntarily I will sacrifice to thee, do it not of necessity. For if the sake of anything else thou praisest God, out of necessity thou praisest. If there were present to thee that which thou lovest, thou wouldest not praise God. See what I say, thou praisest God, for example, in order that he may give thee abundant money. If thou wert to have from any other quarter abundant money, not from God, wouldst thou praise God? If, therefore, because of money thou praisest God, not voluntarily thou sacrificest to God, but out of necessary thou sacrificest, because beside him something else has thy love. Thence hath it been said, voluntarily I will sacrifice to thee. Despise all things, to himself give heed. These things also which he hath given, because of the giver are good things, for he giveth entirely. He giveth these temporal things, and to certain men to their good, to certain men to their harm, after the height and depth of his judgments. At the abyss of which judgments an apostle stood in awe, saying, O the depth of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments, and his ways past finding out. For who shall find out his ways, or who shall comprehend his counsels? He knoweth when he giveth, to whom he giveth, when he taketh away, and from whom he taketh away. Ask thou in this present time that which may profit from thee hereafter. Ask that which may help thee for eternity. But himself without price love thou, because from him thou findest not anything that he may give better than himself. Or if thou findest a better thing, this ask thou, voluntarily I will sacrifice to thee. Wherefore voluntarily? Because gratis. What is gratis? And I will confess to thy name, O Lord, for it is a good thing, for nothing else, but because a good thing it is. Doth he say, I will confess to thy name, O Lord, because thou givest me fruitful manners, because thou givest me gold and silver, because thou givest me extended riches, abundant money, most exalted dignity. Nay, but what? For it is a good thing. Nothing I find better than thy name. Therefore I will confess to thy name, O Lord, for it is a good thing. 11. Verse 7. For out of all tribulation thou hast delivered me. For this cause I have perceived how good a thing is thy name. For if this I were able before tribulations to acknowledge, perchance for me there had been no need of them. But tribulation hath been applied for admonition. Admonition hath rebounded to thy praise. For I should not have understood where I was, except of my weakness I had been admonished. Out of all tribulations, therefore, thou hast delivered me, and upon mine enemies mine eye hath looked back. Upon those Ziphites mine eye hath looked back. Yea, their flower I have passed over in loftiness of heart. Unto thee I have come, and thence I have looked back upon them, and have seen that all flesh is grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of grass. As in a certain place is also said, I have seen the ungodly man to be exalted, and raised up like the cedars of Lebanon. I passed by, and lo, he was not. Wherefore he was not? Because thou hast passed by. What is because thou hast passed by? Because not to no purpose hast thou heard, lift up thy heart. Because not on earth, where thou wouldst have rotted, thou hast remained. Because thou hast lifted up thy soul to God, and thou hast mounted beyond the cedars of Lebanon, and from that elevation hast observed, and lo, he was not. And thou hast sought him, and there hath not been found place for him. No longer is labor before thee, because thou hast entered into the sanctuary of God, and hast understood for the last things. So also here thus he concludeth, And upon mine enemies mine eye hath looked back. This do ye therefore, brethren, with your souls. Lift up your hearts, sharpen the edge of your mind. Learn truly to love God. Learn to despise the present world. Learn voluntarily to sacrifice the offerings of praise, to the end that, mounting beyond the flower of the grass, ye may look back upon your enemies. End of Psalm 54, Part 2. Psalm 55, Part 1 of Expositions on the Book of Psalms, Volume 3. Mount Vernon, Ohio. Expositions on the Book of Psalms, Volume 3, Psalms 53-75, by Saint Augustine of Hippo. Chapter 4. 1. Of this psalm the title is, At the End in Hymns, Understanding to David Himself. What the end is, we will briefly call to your recollection, because ye have known it. For the end of the law is Christ, for righteousness unto every man believing. Be the attention therefore directed unto the end. Wherefore is he called the end? Because whatever we do, to him we refer it, and when to him we shall have come home, more to ask we shall not have. For there is an end spoken of which doth consume, there is an end spoken of which doth make perfect. In one sense, for instance, we understand it, when we hear, there is ended the food which was in eating, and in another sense we understand it when we hear, there is ended the vesture which was in weaving. In each case we hear, there is ended, but the food so that it no longer is, the vesture so that it is perfected. Our end, therefore, ought to be our perfection, Christ. For in him we are made perfect, because of himself, the head of the members, are we. And he hath been spoken of as the end of the law, because without him no one doth make perfect the law. When, therefore, ye hear in the psalms at the end, for many psalms are thus superscribed, be not your thought upon consuming, but upon consummation. In hymns, in praises. For whether we are troubled and are straitened, or whether we rejoice and exult, he is to be praised, who both in tribulations doth instruct, and in gladness doth comfort. For the praise of God from the heart and mouth of a Christian man ought not to depart. Not that he may be praising in prosperity and speaking evil in adversity, but after the manner that this psalm doth prescribe, I will speak good of the Lord in every time, always the praise of him is in my mouth. Thou dost rejoice, acknowledge a father indulging. Thou art troubled, acknowledge a father chastening. Whether he indulge or whether he chasten, he is instructing one for whom he is preparing an inheritance. 3. What then is understanding to David himself? David indeed was, as we know, a holy prophet, king of Israel, son of Jesse. But because of out of his seed there came for our salvation after the flesh of the Lord Jesus Christ, often under that name he is figured, and David instead of Christ is in a figure set down, because the origin of the flesh of the same. For after some sort he is son of David, after some sort the Lord he is of David, son of David after the flesh, Lord of David after the divinity. For if by him have been made all things, by him also David himself hath been made, out of whose seed he came to men. Moreover, when the Lord had questioned the Jews, whose son they affirmed Christ to be, they made answer, David's, where the Lord chides the Jews when they said that he was the son of David. He saw they had stayed at the flesh, and had lost sight of the divinity. And he reproveth them by propounding a question. How then doth David himself in spirit call him Lord? The Lord hath said unto my Lord, Sit on my right hand, until I lay thy foes beneath thy feet. If then he in spirit calleth him Lord, how is he his son? A question he propounded. His being son, he denied not. Ye have heard Lord, say ye how he is his son. Ye have heard son. Say he how he is Lord. Say how he is Lord. This question the Catholic faith solveth. How, Lord? Because in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. How, Son? Because the Word was made flesh, and dwelt among us. Because then David in a figure is Christ, but Christ, as we have often reminded your love, is both head and body. Neither ought we to speak ourselves as alien from Christ, of whom we are members, nor to count ourselves as if we were any other thing, because the two shall be in one flesh. This is a great sacrament, saith the apostle, but I speak in regard of Christ and the church. Because then whole Christ is head and body. When we hear understanding to David himself, understand we ourselves also in David. Let the members of Christ understand, and Christ in his members understand, and the members of Christ in Christ understand, because head and members are one Christ. The head was in heaven, and was saying, Why dost thou persecute me? We with him are in heaven, through hope. Himself is with us on earth through love. Therefore, understanding to David himself. But we admonished when we hear, and let the church understand, for there belongeth to us great diligence to understand in what evil we now are, and from what evil we desire to be delivered, remembering the prayer of the Lord, where at the end we say, Deliver us from evil. Therefore, amid many tribulations of this world, this psalm complaineth somewhat of understanding. He lamenteth not with it, who hath not understanding. But furthermore, dearly beloved, we ought to remember that after the image of God we have been made, and that not in any other part than in the understanding himself. For in many things by beasts we are surpassed. But when a man knoweth himself to have been made after the image of God, therein something in himself he acknowledgeth to be more than hath been given to dumb animals. But on consideration of all those things which a man hath, he findeth himself in this thing peculiarly distinguished from a dumb animal, in that he hath himself an understanding. Whence certain men, despising in themselves that peculiar and especial thing which from their Maker they had received, the Maker himself reproveth, saying, Do not become like horse and mule, in which there is no understanding. And in another place he speaketh of man in honor set. And what honor, except that he is made after the image of God? Therefore, in honor set, he understood not. He saith, He hath been compared unto brutes without sense, and hath been made like unto them. Let us acknowledge, therefore, our honor, and let us understand. If we do understand, we see this not to be the region of rejoicing, but of groaning, not now of exalting, but as yet of lamenting. But even if certain exaltation both dwell in our hearts, not yet is it in substance, but in hope. Because of a thing promised, we are glad, because we know he that promiseth doth not deceive us. Nevertheless, as regardeth the present time, in what evil, in what straits we are, hear ye. And if to this way ye keep, that which ye hear in yourselves acknowledge ye. For whosoever doth not hold to the path of godliness, wondereth that the members of David make such groanings. For he seeth not in himself those things. So long as in himself too those things he seeth not, not yet is he there. He feeleth not that which the body feeleth, because he is beside the body. Let him be embodied, and he shall feel. Let him speak then, and let us hear. Let us hear and speak. 4. Hear thou, O God, my entreaty, and despise not my prayer. Give heed unto me, and hearken unto me. Of one earnest, anxious, of one set in tribulation, are these words. He is praying, suffering many things, from evil yearning to be delivered. It remaineth that we hear in what evil he is, and when he beginneth to speak, let us acknowledge there ourselves to be, in order that the tribulation being shared, we may conjoin prayer. Verse 2, I have been made and in my exercise and have been troubled. We're made sad, we're troubled. In my exercise, he saith. Of evil men whom he suffereth, he hath made mention, and the same suffering of evil men he hath called his exercise. Think ye not that without profit there are evil men in this world, and that no good God maketh of them. Every evil man either on this account liveth that he may be corrected, or on this account liveth that through him a good man may be exercised. O that therefore they do now exercise us would be converted, and together with us be exercised. Nevertheless, so long as they are such as to exercise, let us not hate them, because in that wherein any one of them is evil, whether unto the end he is to persevere, we know not. And oft times, when to thyself thou seemest to have been hating an enemy, thou hast been hating a brother, and knowest not. The devil and his angels in the holy scriptures have been manifested to us, that for fire everlasting they have been destined. Of them only must amendment be despaired of, against whom we have a secret wrestling, for which wrestling the apostle armeth us, saying, Our wrestling is not against flesh and blood, that is, against men whom ye see, but against princes and powers and rulers of the world of this darkness. Lest perchance when he hath said of the world, Thou shouldest understand demons to be rulers of heaven and earth, and he hath said of the world of this darkness, of the world he hath spoken, of the lovers of the world he hath spoken of ungodly and unrighteous men, of the world he hath spoken, whereof saith the gospel, and the world knew him not. For if the world knew not light, because light shineth in the darkness, and darkness comprehended it not, and this darkness itself, which comprehended not light present, is called the name of the world. Then of this darkness they are the rulers. Concerning these same rulers, therefore, we have a definite sentence of Scripture, that from thence no return at all of any one of them is to be hoped for. But truly of the darknesses themselves, of whom these are the rulers, we are not sure, whether perchance they that were darkness may not be made light. For instance, to them that were lately made believers, saith the apostle, Ye have been sometime darkness, but now light in the Lord. Darkness in yourselves, light in the Lord. Therefore, brethren, all evil men, while they are evil men, do exercise good men. For behold, hear ye briefly and understand. If thou art a good man, thou wilt have no enemy but a bad man. Moreover, before thee this rule of goodness hath been set, that thou shouldest imitate the goodness of thy Father, who maketh his sun to rise on good men and on evil men, and reigneth on just men and unjust men. For thou hast not an enemy that God hath not. Thou indeed hast for enemy him that with thee hath been created, but he him that he hath created. of enemies, therefore, of God, of evil men and unrighteous men, often in the Scriptures we read, and he spareth them, who hath nothing that the enemy may lay to his charge, to whom every enemy is ungrateful, for from him he hath whatever of good he hath, for from him he hath it in mercy, even whatever thing there is whereby he is troubled. For to this end he is troubled, that he not be proud. To this end he is troubled, in order that, being humbled, he may acknowledge the highest. Thou therefore on thy enemy, whom hardly thou sufferest, hast bestowed what? If he hath him for enemy, that hath bestowed so great things on him, and maketh his sun to rise on good men and evil men, and raineth on just men and unjust men. Thou that neither canst make the sun to rise, nor upon the lands make rain, canst thou not keep one thing for thine enemy, so that there may be to thee peace on earth to a man of good will? Therefore, since this rule of love for thee is fixed, that imitating the Father thou shouldest love an enemy, for he saith, Love your enemies. In this precept how wouldst thou be exercised, if thou hadst no enemy to suffer? Thou seest then that he profiteth thee somewhat. And let God sparing evil men profit thee, so that thou show mercy, because perchance thou too, if thou art a good man, out of an evil man hast been made a good man. And if God spared not evil men, not even thou wouldst be found to return thanks. May he therefore spare others, that hath spared thee also. For it were not right, when thou hadst passed through, to close up the way of godliness. Whence then doth this man pray, set among evil men, and with whose enemies he was being exercised? Why saith he, I have been made sad in my exercise, and have been troubled? While he is extending his love so as to love enemies, he hath been affected with disgust, being bayed at all around by the enmities of many men, by the frenzy of many, and under a sort of human infirmity he hath sunk. He hath seen himself now begin to be pierced through with an evil suggestion of the devil, to bring on hatred against his enemies, wrestling against hatred in order to perfect love herself in the very fight, and in the wrestling he hath been troubled. For there is his voice, also in another psalm, Mine eye hath been troubled because of anger. And what followeth there? I have waxen old among all mine enemies. As if in storm and waves he were beginning to sink, like Peter. For he doth trample the waves of this world, that loveth enemies. Christ on the sea was walking fearless, from whose heart there could not be any means be taken away the love of an enemy, who, hanging on the cross, did say, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Peter, too, would walk. He as head, Peter as body, because upon this rock, he saith, I will build my church. He was bidden to walk, and he was walking by the grace of him bidding, not by his own strength. But when he saw the wind mighty, he feared, and then he began to sink, being troubled in his exercise. By what mighty wind? Verse 3. By the voice of the enemy, and by the tribulation of the sinner. Therefore, in the same manner as he cried out on the waves, Lord, I perish, save me, a similar voice from this man hath proceeded. Hearken thou, O God, to my entreaty, and despise not my prayer. Give heed unto me, and hearken unto me. Wherefore? For what sufferest thou? Of what dost thou groan? I have been made sad in my exercise. To be exercised indeed amid evil men thou hast set me, but too much they have risen up beyond my powers. Calm thou one troubled, stretch forth a hand to one sinking. I have been made sad in my exercise, and have been troubled by the voice of the enemy and by the tribulation of the sinner, for they have brought down upon me iniquity, and in anger they were shadowing me. Ye have heard of waves and wind. One, as it were, humbled, they were insulting, and he was praying on every side against him with the roar of insult they were raging. But he within was calling him whom they did not see. 6. When some such thing as a Christian's lot to suffer, he ought not lightly, as if in hatred, to proceed against that man by whom he is suffering, and to will to conquer the wind, but to turn himself to prayer, that he lose not love. For we must not fear that a human enemy can do anything. For what is he to do? To say many evil things, to hurl reproaches, to rage with revilings. But to thee what? Rejoice, he saith, and exult, for your reward is great in the heavens. He on earth redoubteth reproaches, thou in heaven thy gains. But let him rage more, he might do yet something more. What is more secure than thou, to whom hath said, Fear not them that kill the body, but the soul they cannot kill? What then is to be feared, when then thou sufferest an enemy? Lest thy love be troubled wherewith thou lovest an enemy. For that human enemy, being flesh and blood, desireth that which he seeth in thee. But another hidden enemy, ruler of this darkness, which thou sufferest in flesh and blood, is seeking the other hidden thing of thine. Two enemies, therefore, set thou before thine eyes, the one open and the other hidden, the open a man, the hidden the devil. This man is the same as thou art after human nature, but after faith and love not yet that which thou art, but will be able to be that which thou art. Since therefore there are two, the one see thou, the other perceive thou, the one love thou, of the other beware. For even that enemy, whom thou seest, would humble that thing in thee wherein he is conquered. For instance, if by thy riches he is conquered, poor he would make thee. If by thy honor he is conquered, humble he would make thee. If by thy powers he is conquered, weak he would make thee. To these things therefore he giveth heed, in thee either to throw down or to take away the things whereby he is conquered. That hidden enemy also from thee would take away that thing wherein he is conquered. For being man, thou conquerest a man in human felicity, but the devil thou conquerest in love of an enemy. In like manner, then, as a man goeth about to take away from thee, and to cut short, or to overthrow the felicity wherein he is conquered, so also the devil conquers a man by taking away that wherein he is conquered. But take care in heart to hold fast the love of an enemy, wherewith the devil is conquered of thee. Let a man rage as much as he can, let him take whatever he can. If he is loved that is openly raging, he hath been conquered who is secretly raging. 7. But this man, being troubled and made sad, was praying. His eye was being disturbed, as it were, on account of anger. But the anger of a brother, if it shall have been inveterate, is then hatred. Anger doth trouble the eye, hatred doth quench it. Anger is a straw, hatred is a beam. Sometimes thou hatest and chidest an angry man. In thee is hatred, in him whom thou chidest anger. With reasons to thee is said, Cast out first the beam from thine own eye, and so thou shalt see to cast out the straw from thy brother's eye. For that ye may know how much difference there is between anger and hatred. Day by day men are angry with their sons. Show me them that hate their sons. This man, being troubled, was praying even when made sad, wrestling against all revilings of all revilers, not in order that he might conquer any one of them by giving back reviling, but that he might not hate any one of them. Hence he prayeth, hence asketh, from the voice of the enemy and from the tribulation of the sinner, for they have brought down upon me iniquity, and in anger they were shadowing me. Verse 4, My heart hath been troubled in me. This is the same as elsewhere hath been said, Mine eye because of anger hath been troubled. And if eye hath been troubled, what followeth? And fear of death hath fallen upon me. Our life is love. If life is love, death is hatred. When a man hath begun to fear lest he should hate him that he was loving, it is death he is fearing, and a sharper death, and a more inward death, whereby the soul is killed, not body. Thou didst mind a man raging against thee. What was he to do, against whom thine own Lord had given thee security, saying, fear not them that kill the body. He by raging killeth body, thou by keeping hatred hast killed soul, and be the body of another, thou thine own soul. Fear, therefore, if death hath fallen upon me. 8. Verse 5. Fearfulness and trembling have come upon me, and darkness have covered me. And I have said, He that hateth his brother is in darkness until now. If love is light, hatred is darkness. And what saith to himself one said in that weakness and troubled in that exercise? Verse 6. Who shall give me wings as to a dove, and I shall fly and shall rest? Either for death he was wishing, or for solitude he was longing. So long, he saith, as this is the work with me, as this command is given me, that I should love enemies, the revilings of these men, increasing and shadowing me, do derange mine eye, perturb my sight, penetrate my heart, slay my soul. I could wish to depart, but weak I am, lest by abiding I should add sins to sins, or at least may I be separated for a little space from mankind, lest my wound suffer from frequent blows, in order that when it hath been made whole it may be brought back to the exercise. This is what takes place, brethren. And there ariseth oft times in the mind of the servant of God a longing for solitude, for no other reason than because of the multitude of tribulations and scandals, and he saith, Who shall give me wings? Doth he find himself without wings, or rather with bound wings? If they are wanting, be they given. If bound, be they loosed. Because even he that looseth a bird's wings either giveth or giveth back to it its wings. For it had not as though its own them wherewith it could not fly. Bound wings make a burden. Who, he saith, shall give me wings as to a dove, and I shall fly and shall rest. Shall rest where? I have said there are two senses here, either, as saith the apostle, to be dissolved and to be with Christ, for it is by far the best thing. For he too, although strong, although great, although in heart most stout, although in Christ a soldier invincible, in his exercise, as we read, was troubled, and he saith, Henceforth let not any one be vexatious to me. As though he were saying out of that psalm, Weariness hath gotten hold on me because of sinners forsaking thy law. Therefore a man oft times endeavoureth to amend men perverted, crooked, belonging indeed to his care, but men in whom there is but failure for all human pains and vigilance, amend he cannot, suffer them he must. Even he that amended cannot be is thine, either by the fellowship of the human race, or oft times by church communion. He is within. What wilt thou do? Whither wilt go? Whither separate thyself in order that these things thou mayest not suffer? But go to him, speak, exhort, coax, threaten, reprove. I have done all things. Whatever powers I had, I have expanded and have drained. Nothing I see have I prevailed. All my labor hath been spent out. Sorrow hath remained. How then shall my heart rest from such men, except, I say, who shall give me wings? As to a dove, however, not as to a raven. A dove seeketh a flying away from troubles, but she loseth not love. For a dove, as a type of love, is set forth, and in her the plaint is loved. Nothing is so fond of plaints as a dove. Day and night she complaineth, as though she were set here where she ought to complain. What then saith this lover? Revilings of men to bear I am unable. They roar with frenzy, are carried away, are inflamed with indignation. In anger they shadow me. To do good to them I am unable. Oh, that I might rest somewhere, being separated from them in body, not in love, lest in me there should be troubled love itself. With my words and my speech no good can I do them. By praying for them, perchance I shall do good. These words men say, but oft times they are so bound that to fly they are not able. For perchance they are not bound with any bird-lime, but are bound by duty. but they are bound with care and duty, and to leave it are unable. Let them say, I was wishing to be dissolved and to be with Christ, for it is by far the best thing. To abide in the flesh is necessary because of you. A dove bound back by affection, not by cupidity, to fly away was not able because of duty to be fulfilled, not because of little merit. Nevertheless, a longing in heart must needs be, nor doth any man suffer this longing, but he that hath begun to walk in that narrow way, in order that he may know that there are not wanting to the church persecutions, even in this time, when a calm is seen in the church, at least with respect to those persecutions which our martyrs have suffered. But there are not wanting persecutions, because a true saying is this, all that will godly to live in Christ shall suffer persecution. Thou sufferest not persecution. Thou willest not godly to live in Christ. Dost thou will to prove that to be a true saying which hath been said? Begin godly to live in Christ. What is it godly to live in Christ? So that this may belong to thy bowels, whereof the apostle speaketh, who is weak, and I am not weak, who was offended, and I burn not. Other men's infirmities, other men's offenses, were to him persecutions. Are they then wanting at this time? More do abound to them that mind these things. And ofttimes from afar a man is seen, and it is said of him, it is well with him. And he that saith it is either tasting his own matters, and is not able to taste those of others, or of himself hath not whereof he may taste, and with another man tasting, nay devouring, he suffereth not. Let him begin therefore godly to live in Christ, and prove that which is said, he beginneth to long for wings, to go afar off, to flee, and to abide in the desert. End of Psalm 55, Part 1. Psalm 55, Part 2 of Expositions on the Book of Psalms, Volume 3, Mount Vernon, Ohio. Exposition on the Book of Psalms, Volume 3, Psalms 53-75, by Saint Augustine of Hippo. Chapter 5. 9. For whence it is, think ye, brethren, that the servants of God have thronged the deserts? If well with them it were amid men, would they withdraw from men? And yet what would they do, even these same? Behold, they go afar off, fleeing. They abide in the desert. But do they one by one? There holdeth them love, so that with many they abide. And from these same many there came forth some to exercise them. Because in every congregation of a multitude there must needs be found evil men. For God knoweth that we must be exercised, mingled with us even men that are not to persevere, or certainly so counterfeit, so they have not so much as begun that wherein they ought to persevere. For he knoweth that it is necessary for us that we bear evil men, and the good there is in what we are should advance. Let us love enemies, rebuke, chastise, excommunicate, with love from us even separate them. For see what saith the apostle, but if any one obey not our word through the epistle, him mark ye, and be not mingled together with him. But let there not steal upon thee because of this thing indignation, and trouble thine eye. Not, he saith, as an enemy esteem him, but rebuke him as a brother, that he may blush. From him whom he proclaimeth separation, he cutteth not off love. That eye liveth, thy life liveth. For love lost is thy death. This he hath feared to lose that hath said, fear of death hath fallen upon me. Accordingly, lest I should lose the life of love, who shall give me wings as to a dove, and I shall fly and shall rest? Whither art thou to go? Whither to fly? Where to rest? Verse 7. Behold, I have gone afar fleeing, and have abode in the desert. In what desert? Wherever thou shalt be, there will gather them together other men. The desert with thee they will seek, will attach themselves to thy life. Thou canst not thrust back the society of brethren. There are mingled with thee also evil men, still exercise as thy due portion. Behold, I have gone afar, and have abode in the desert. In what desert? It is perchance in the conscience, whither no man entereth, where no one is with thee, where thou art and God. For if in the desert, in any place, what wilt thou do with men gathering themselves together? For thou wilt not be able to be separated from mankind, so long as among men thou livest. Observe rather that Comforter, our Lord and King, our Ruler and Creator, created also among us. Observe that with his 12 he joined one man whom he was to suffer. 10. Behold, I have gone afar fleeing, and have abode in the desert. Perchance that man, as I have said, hath fled unto his conscience. There some little desert he will have found where he may rest. But that love doth trouble him. Alone he found himself in conscience, but not alone in charity. Within he was comforted in conscience, but without tribulations left him not. Therefore in himself at peace, on others depending, when he was yet being troubled, he saith what? Verse 8. I was looking for him that should save me from weakness of mind and tempest. See, there is, tempest there is. Nothing for thee remaineth but to cry out, Lord, I perish. Let him stretch forth hand, who doth the waves tread fearlessly. Let him relieve thy dread. Let him confirm himself thy security. Let him speak to thee within, and say to thee, Give heed to me, what I have borne. An evil brother, perchance, thou art suffering, or an enemy without art suffering. Which of these have I not suffered? There roared without Jews, within a disciple was betraying. There rageth therefore tempest, but he doth save men from weakness of mind and tempest. Perchance thy ship is being troubled, because he in thee is sleeping. The sea was raging, the bark wherein the disciples were sailing was tossed, but Christ was sleeping. At length it was seen by them that among them was sleeping the ruler and creator of winds. They drew near and awoke Christ. He commanded the winds, and there was a great calm. With reason then perchance thy heart is troubled, because thou hast forgotten him on whom thou hast believed. Beyond endurance thou art suffering, because it hath not come into thy mind what for thee Christ hath borne. If unto thy mind cometh not Christ, he sleepeth. Awake, Christ, recall faith. For then in thee Christ is sleeping. If thou hast forgotten the sufferings of Christ, then in thee Christ is watching, if thou hast remembered the sufferings of Christ. But when the full heart thou shalt have considered what he hath suffered, wilt not thou too with equanimity endure, and perchance rejoicing, because thou hast been found in some likeness of the sufferings of thy King. When, therefore, on these things thinking, thou hast begun to be comforted and to rejoice, he hath arisen. He hath commanded the winds. Therefore there is a great calm. I was looking for him that should save me from weakness of mind and tempest. 11. Verse 9. Sink, O Lord, and divide the tongues of them. He is referring to men troubling him and shadowing him, and he hath wished this thing not of anger, brethren. They that have wickedly lifted up themselves, for them it is expedient that they be sunk. They that have wickedly conspired, it is expedient for them that their tongues should be divided. To good let them consent, and let their tongues agree together. But if to one purpose there were whispering against me, he saith, all mine enemies, let them loose their one purpose in evil. Divided be the tongues of them. Let them not with themselves agree together. Sink, O Lord, and divide the tongues of them. Wherefore sink? Because themselves they have lifted up. Wherefore divide? Because for an evil thing they have united. Recollect that tower of proud men made after the deluge. What said the proud men? Lest we perish in a deluge, let us make a lofty tower. In pride they were thinking themselves to be fortified. They builded up a lofty tower, and the Lord divided the tongues of them. Then they began not to understand one another. Hence arose the beginning of many tongues. For before one tongue there was, but one tongue for men agreeing was good, one tongue for humble men was good. But when that gathering together did into a union of pride fall headlong, God spared them, even though he divided the tongues, lest by understanding one another they should make a destructive unity. Through proud men divided were the tongues, through humble apostles united were the tongues. Spirit of pride dispersed tongues, spirit holy united tongues. For when the Holy Spirit came upon the disciples, with tongues of all men they spake. By all men they were understood. Tongues dispersed into one were united. Therefore, if still they rage and are Gentiles, it is expedient for them divided to have their tongues. They would have one tongue. Let them come to the church, because even among the diversity of tongues of flesh, one is the tongue in faith of heart. Sink, O Lord, and divide the tongues of them. 12. For I have seen iniquity and contradiction in the city. With reason this man was seeking the desert, for he saw iniquity and contradiction in the city. There is a certain city turbulent. The same it was that was building a tower. The same was confounded and called Babylon. The same through innumerable nations dispersed. Thence is gathered the church into the desert of a good conscience. For he saw contradiction in the city. Christ cometh. What Christ? Thou contradictest. Son of God. And hath God a son? Thou contradictest. He was born of a virgin, suffered, rose again. And whence is it possible for this to be done? Thou contradictest. Give heed at least to the glory of the cross itself. Now on the brow of kings that cross hath been fixed, over which enemies insulted. The effect hath proved the virtue. It hath subdued the world, not with steel, but with wood. The wood of the cross, deserving of insults, hath seemed to enemies, and before the wood itself standing, they were wagging the head, and saying, If Son of God he is, let him come down from the cross. He was stretching forth his hands to a people, unbelieving and contradicting. For if just he is that of faith liveth, unjust is he that hath not faith. By that which here he said iniquity, I understand unbelief. The Lord therefore was seeing in the city iniquity and contradiction, and was stretching forth his hands to a people unbelieving and contradicting. And nevertheless, waiting for these same, he was saying, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Even now, indeed, there rage the remnant of that city. Even now they contradict. From the brows of all men, now he is stretching forth hands to the remnant unbelieving and contradicting. For I have seen iniquity and contradiction in the city. 13. Verse 10. Day and night there will compass it upon the walls thereof iniquity and labor. Upon the walls thereof. Upon the fortifications thereof, holding, as it were, the heads thereof, the noble men thereof. If that noble man were a Christian, not one would remain a pagan. Ofttimes men say, no one would remain a pagan if he were a Christian. Ofttimes men say, if he too were made a Christian, who would remain a pagan? Because therefore not yet they are made Christians, as if walls they are of that city unbelieving and contradicting. How long shall these walls stand? Not always shall they stand. The ark is going around the walls of Jericho. There shall come a time at the seventh going around of the ark, when all the walls of the city unbelieving and contradicting shall fall. Until it come to pass, this man is being troubled in his exercise, and enduring the remains of men contradicting, he would choose wings for flying away, and would choose the rest of the desert. Yea, let him continue amid men contradicting. Let him endure menaces, drink revilings, and look for him that will save him from weakness of mind and tempest. Let him look upon the head, the pattern for his life. Let him be made calm in hope, even if he is troubled in fact. Day and night they will compass it upon the walls thereof iniquity, and labor in the midst thereof and injustice. And for this reason labor is there, because iniquity is there, because injustice is there. Therefore also labor is there. But let them hear him stretching forth hands. Come unto me, all ye that labor. Ye cry, ye contradict, ye revile. He, on the contrary, come unto me, all ye that labor in your pride, and ye shall rest in my humility. Learn of me, he saith, for meek I am, and humble in heart, and ye shall find rest unto your souls. For whence do they labor, but because they are not meek and humble in heart? God humble was made. Let man blush to be proud. 14. Verse 11. There hath not failed from the streets thereof usury and deceit. Usury and deceit are not hidden, at least, because they are evil things, but in public they rage. For he that in his house doth any evil thing, however for his evil thing doth blush. In the streets thereof usury and deceit, money-lending even hath a profession. Money-lending also is called a science. A corporation is spoken of, a corporation as if necessary to the state, and of its profession it payeth revenue. So entirely indeed in the streets is that which should have been hidden. There is also another usury worse, when thou forgivest not that which to thee is owed, and the eye is disturbed in that verse of the prayer, Forgive us our debts, as we too forgive our debtors. For what there wilt thou do, when thou art going to pay, and coming to that same verse? An insulting word thou hast heard. Thou wouldst exact the punishment of condemnation. Do but consent to exact just so much as thou hast given, thou usurer of injuries. With the fist thou hast been smitten, slaying thou seekest. Evil usury, how wilt thou go to prayer? If thou shalt have left praying, which way wilt thou come round unto the Lord? Behold, thou wilt say, Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so on earth. Thou wilt say, Our daily bread give us today. Thou wilt come to, Forgive us our debts, as we also forgive our debtors. Even in that evil city, let there abound these usuries. Let them not enter the walls where the breast is smitten. What wilt thou do? Because there thou and that verse are in the midst, petitions for thee hath a heavenly lawyer composed. He that knew what used there to be done said to thee, Otherwise thou shalt not obtain. Verily, verily, I say unto you, that if ye shall have forgiven men sins, but if ye shall not have forgiven sins unto men, neither will your Father forgive you. Who saith this? He that knoweth what there is being done, in the place whereat thou art standing to make request. See how himself willed to be thy advocate, himself the lawyer, himself the assessor of the Father, himself thy judge hath said, Otherwise thou shalt not receive. What wilt thou do? Thou wilt not receive, unless thou shalt speak. Wilt not receive, if falsely thou shalt speak. Therefore either thou must do and speak, or else what thou askest thou wilt not earn. Because they that this do not do are in the midst of those evil usuries. Be they engaged therein, that yet do idols either adore or desire. Do not thou, O people of God, do not thou, O people of Christ, do not thou the body of him the head. Give heed to the bond of thy peace. Give heed to the promise of thy life. For what doth it profit thee, that thou exactest for injuries which thou hast endured? Doth vengeance refresh thee? Therefore, over the evil of another shalt thou rejoice? Thou hast suffered evil. Pardon now. Be not ye too. And there faileth not from the streets thereof usury and deceit. 15. Therefore, for this reason thou wast seeking solitude and wings. For this reason thou art complaining. These things to bear thou art not able, namely the contradiction and iniquity of this city. Rest thou in these things which with thee are within, and do not seek solitude. Hear also of those very things what he saith. Verse 12. For if an enemy had upbraided me, and indeed above he was troubled in his exercise by the voice of the enemy, and by the tribulation of the sinner, perhaps being placed in that city, that proud city that was building a tower, which was sunk, that divided might be the tongues, give heed to his inward groaning because of perils from false brethren. For if an enemy had upbraided me, I would have undergone it assuredly, and if he that did hate me had over me great words spoken, that is, through pride had on me trampled, did magnify himself above me, did threaten me all in his power, I would hide myself assuredly from him. From him that is abroad, thou wouldst hide thyself where? Amid those that are within. But now see whether anything else remaineth, but that thou seek solitude. Verse 13. But thou, he saith, man of one mind, my guide and my friend. Perchance sometimes good counsel thou hast given. Perchance sometimes thou hast gone before me, and some wholesome advice thou hast given me. In the church of God together we have been. But thou, man of one mind, my God and my friend, verse 14, that together with me didst take sweet morsels. What are the sweet morsels? Not all they that are present know, but let them not be soured, that do know, in order that they may be able to say to them that as yet know not, taste ye and see how sweet is the Lord. Thou that together with me didst take sweet morsels, in the house of God we have walked with consent. Whence then dissension? Thou that wast within hast become one without. He hath walked with me in the house of God with consent. Another house hath he set up against the house of God. Wherefore hath that been forsaken, wherein we have walked with consent? Wherefore hath that been deserted, wherein together we did take sweet morsels? 16. Verse 15. Let there come death upon them, and let them go down unto hell living. How hath he cited and hath made us call to mind that first beginning of schism, when in that first people of the Jews certain proud men separated themselves, and would without have sacrificed. A new death upon them came. The earth opened herself and swallowed them alive. Let there come, he saith, death upon them, and let them go down into hell living. What is living? Knowing that they are perishing and yet perishing. Hear of living men perishing and being swallowed up in a gulf of the earth, that is, being swallowed up in the voraciousness of earthly desires. Thou sayest to a man, what aileth thee, brother? Brethren, we are one God we invoke, in one Christ we believe, one gospel we hear, one psalm we sing, one amen we respond, one hallelujah we sound, one Easter we celebrate. Why art thou without, and I am within? Oft times one straitened and perceiving how true are the charges which are made, saith, may God requite our ancestors. Therefore, alive he perisheth. In the next place, thou continuest and thou givest warning. At least the evil of separation stand alone. Why doth thou adjoin thereto that of rebaptism? Acknowledge in me what thou hast, and if thou hatest me, Christ in me spare thou. And this evil thing doth frequently and very greatly displease them. Truly, say they, it is ill done. Oh, that it were possible not to have it done. But what have we to do with the statutes of our ancestors? Let them go down into hell living. If being dead thou shouldst go down, what thou wert doing thou wouldst not know. But when thou knowest that to be an evil thing which thou doest, and nevertheless doest it, dost thou not alive go down into the lower places? And why is it that a gulf of the earth swallowed up alive the rulers themselves, for the most part, but the people that with them consented, fire falling from heaven consumed? It is on this account that this psalm referring to this punishment with the people hath begun, and with the leaders hath concluded. Let there come death upon them, it hath said, because of them upon whom there came fire from heaven. And immediately hath continued, let them go down into hell living, because of the leaders whom a gulf of the earth swallowed up. How should they have descended unto hell living, of whom it had said, let there come death upon them? If already upon them death had come, how alive unto the lower places did they descend? Therefore with the lesser ones he hath begun, with the greater he hath concluded, let there come death upon them that have consented and have followed. What of those leaders and princes? Let them go down into hell living, because they themselves have the scriptures in their hands, and know well by daily reading how the Church Catholic throughout the whole world is so spread, that in a word all contradiction is void, and that there cannot be found any support for their schism they know well. Therefore unto the lower places living they go down, because the evil which they do evil to be they know, but the former a fire of divine indignation consumed, for being inflamed with desire of strife from their evil leaders they would not depart. There came upon fire a fire, upon the heat of dissension the heat of consuming. Let there come death upon them, and let them go down into hell living. For naughtiness is in their lodgings in the midst of them, in their lodgings wherein they tarry and pass away. For here they are not alway to be, and nevertheless in defence of a temporal animosity they are fighting so fiercely. In their lodgings is iniquity, in the midst of them is iniquity. No part of them is so near the middle of them as their heart. 17, verse 16. Therefore to the Lord I have cried out. The body of Christ and the oneness of Christ in anguish, in weariness, in uneasiness, in the tribulation of its exercise, that one man, oneness in one body set, when he was wearying his soul and crying out from the ends of the earth, saith, from the ends of the earth to thee I have cried out, when my heart was being vexed. Himself one, but a oneness that one. And himself one, not in one place one, but from the ends of the earth is crying as one. How from the ends of the earth should there cry one, except in many there were one? I to the Lord have cried out. Rightly do they cry out to the Lord. Cry not to Donatus, lest for thee be instead of the Lord a Lord, that under the Lord would not be a fellow servant. I to the Lord have cried out, and the Lord hath heard me. End of section 5. Psalm 55, part 3 of Expositions on the Book of Psalms, volume 3, Mount Vernon, Ohio. Expositions on the Book of Psalms, volume 3, Psalms 53-75, by Saint Augustine of Hippo, chapter 6. 18, verse 18. In evening, in morning, at noonday, I will recount and will tell forth, and he shall hearken to my voice. Do thou proclaim glad tidings, keep not in secret that which thou hast received, in evening of things gone by, in morning of things to be, at noonday of things ever to be. Therefore to that which he saith in evening belongeth to that which he recounteth. To that which he saith in morning belongeth that which he telleth forth. To that which he saith at noonday belongeth that wherein his voice is hearkened to. For the end is at noonday, that is to say, whence there is no going down into setting. For at noonday there is light full high, the splendor of wisdom, the fervor of love. In evening and morning and at noonday. In evening the Lord on the cross, in morning in resurrection, in noonday in ascension. I will recount in evening the patience of him dying. I will tell forth in morning the life of him rising. I will pray that he hearken at noonday sitting at the right hand of the Father. He shall hearken to my voice that intercedeth for us. How great is the security of this man! How great the consolation! How great the refuge from weakness of mind and tempest, against evil men, against ungodly men, both without and within, and in the case of those that are without, though they had been within. 19. Therefore, my brethren, those that in the very congregation of these walls ye see to be rebellious men, proud, seeking their own, lifted up, not having a zeal for God that is chaste, sound, quiet, but ascribing to themselves much, ready for dissension, but not finding opportunity, are the very chaff of the Lord's floor. From hence these few men the wind of pride hath dislodged. The whole floor will not fly, save when he at the last shall winnow. But what shall we do, save with this man sing, with this man pray, with this man mourn, and say securely, verse 18, he shall redeem in peace my soul. Against them that love not peace, in peace he shall redeem my soul, because with those that hated peace I was peace-making. He shall redeem in peace my soul, from those that draw near to me. For from those that are afar from me it is an easy case. Not so soon doth he receive me that saith, Come, pray to an idol, he is very far from me. Art thou a Christian? A Christian, he saith, out of a neighboring place he is my adversary. He is at hand. He shall redeem in peace my soul from those that draw near to me, for in many things they were with me. Wherefore have I said, Draw near to me? Because in many things they were with me. In this verse two propositions occur. In many things they were with me. Baptism we had, both of us, in that they were with me. The gospel we both read, they were in that with me. The festivals of martyrs we celebrated, they were there with me. But not entirely with me. In schism, not with me. In heresy, not with me. In many things with me, in a few things not with me. But in these few things wherein not with me, there is no profit to them of the many things wherein they were with me. For see, brethren, how many things hath recounted the Apostle Paul. One thing he hath said, If it shall have been wanting, in vain are those things. If with the tongues of men and of angels I shall speak, he saith, If I have all prophecy and all faith and all knowledge, if mountains I shall remove, if I shall bestow all my gods upon the poor, if I shall deliver my body even so that it be burned, how many things he hath enumerated. To all these many things let there be wanting one thing, charity. The former in number are more, the latter in weight is greater. Therefore in all sacraments they are with me, in one charity not with me. In many things they were with me. Again by a different expression, for in many things they were with me. They that themselves have separated from me, with me they were, not in few things, but in many things. For throughout the whole world few are the grains, many are the chaffs. Therefore he saith what? In chaff with me they were, in wheat with me they were not. And the chaff is nearly related to the wheat. From one seed it goeth forth, in one field is rooted, with one rain is nourished. The same reaper it suffereth, the same threshing sustaineth, the same winnowing awaiteth, not into one barn entereth. For in many things they were with me. 20. Verse 19. God will hear me, and he shall humble them that is before ages. For they rely on some leader or others of theirs that hath begun but yesterday. He shall humble them that is before ages. For even with reference to time, Christ is of Mary the Virgin. Nevertheless, before ages, in the beginning he is the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word with God, and the Word God. He shall humble them, that is, before ages. For to them is no changing. Of them I speak to whom is no changing. He knew of some to persevere, and in the perseverance of their own wickedness to die. For we see them, and to them is no changing. They that die in that same perverseness, in that same schism, to them is no changing. God shall humble them in damnation, because they are exalted in dissension. To them is no changing, because they are not changed for the better, but for the worse, neither while they are here nor in the resurrection. For all we shall rise again, but not all shall be changed. Wherefore? Because to them is no changing, and they have not feared God. My brethren, one remedy there is, let them fear God. Let them forsake Donatus. Thou sayest to him, thou art perishing in schism. It must needs be that God should require those evil things. Thou wilt come unto damnation. Flatter not thyself with thy words. Follow not a blind guide. For a blind man leading a blind man, together into a ditch do they fall. What is that to me? He saith, as I have lived yesterday, so also today. What my parents were, the same also am I. Thou fearest not God. Give fear to God. Let him think that all these things are true which are read, that the faithfulness of Christ is that which cannot be broken. How in heresy shall he remain in the face of so great evidentness of the Holy Catholic Church, which God hath diffused throughout the whole world, which before he diffused, he promised, foretold, hath so manifested as he promised? Therefore let them be aware, and mark that fear not God. Verse 20. He stretcheth forth his hand in requiting. 21. They have polluted his testament. Read the testament which they have polluted. In thy seed shall be blessed all nations. They have polluted his testament. Thou against these words of the testator sayeth what? The Africa of holy Donatus hath alone deserved this grace. In him hath remained the church of Christ. Say at least the church of Donatus. Wherefore addest thou of Christ? Of whom it is said, in thy seed shall be blessed all nations. After Donatus wilt thou go? Set aside Christ, and then secede. See therefore what followeth. They have polluted his testament. What testament? To Abraham have been spoken the promises, and to his seed. The apostle saith, nevertheless a man's testament confirmed no one maketh void, or superaddeth to. To Abraham have been spoken the promises, and to his seed. He saith not, and to seeds as if many, but as if in one, and to thy seed which is Christ. In this Christ, therefore, what testament hath been promised? In thy seed shall be blessed all nations. Thou that hast given up the unity of all nations, and in a part hast remained, hast polluted his testament. That which therefore hath befallen thee to be banished. To be from the inheritance separated is of the anger of God. For attend to that which followeth. They have polluted his testament. They have been divided because of the anger of his countenance. What do ye look for? By what clearer mark should heretics be pointed out? They have been divided because of the anger of his countenance. 22. Verse 22. And his heart hath drawn near. Of whom do we understand it, except of him by the anger of whom they have been divided? How hath his heart drawn near? In such sort that we may understand his will. For by heretics hath been vindicated the Catholic Church, and by those that evil think have been proved those that think well. For many things lay hid in the Scriptures, and when heretics had been cut off, with questions they troubled the Church of God. Then those things were opened which lay hid, and the will of God was understood. Thence is said in another psalm, a congregation of bulls amid cows of the people, in order that they might be excluded that have been proved with silver. For let them be excluded. He hath said, let them come forth, let them appear. Whence even in silver-working men are called excluders, that is, pressers out of form from the sort of confusion of the lump. Therefore many men that very excellently could the Scriptures understand and expound were hidden among the people of God. But they did not declare the solution of difficult questions when no reviler again urged them. For was the Trinity perfectly treated of before the Arians snarled thereat? Was repentance perfectly treated of before the Novatians opposed? So not perfectly of baptism was it treated before rebaptizers set without contradicted. Nor of the very oneness of Christ were the doctrines clearly stated which have been stated, save after that this separation began to press upon the weak, in order that they that knew how to treat of and solve these questions, lest the weak should perish vexed with the questions of the ungodly, by their discourses and disputations should bring out unto open day the dark things of the law. Therefore they have been divided because of the anger of his countenance, and unto us for understanding his heart hath drawn near. Therefore perceive ye that which in another psalm he hath mentioned, congregation of bulls, that is, of proud smiters with horns, amid the cows of the people. What doth he speak of as cows? Souls easy to be led astray. Why this? In order that those may be excluded, that is, may appear that were lying hid, that have been proved with silver. What is with silver? With the saying of God. The sayings of God are sayings chased silver with fire tried, the thing approved of the earth, purged seven times so much. This obscure sense see in what manner the apostle bringeth out into light. It is needful, he saith, that also heresies there be, in order that men proved may be made manifest among you. What is men proved? Proved with silver, proved with the word. What is may be manifest? May be brought out. Wherefore this? Because of heretics. What is because of heretics? Because of the congregation of bulls amid the cows of the people. So, therefore, these also have been divided because of the anger of his countenance, and his heart hath drawn near. 23, verse 21. His discourses have been softened above oil, and themselves are darts. For certain things of the scriptures were seeming hard, while they were obscure. When explained, they have been softened. For even the first heresy in the disciples of Christ, as it were from the hardness of his discourse, arose. For when he said, Except a man shall have eaten my flesh and shall have drunk my blood, he shall not have life in himself. They, not understanding, said to one another, Hard is this discourse, who can hear it? Saying that, Hard is this discourse, they separated from him. He remained with the others, the 12. When they had intimated to him that by his discourse they had been scandalized, Will ye also, he saith, choose to go? Then Peter, The word of life eternal thou hast. To whom shall we go? Attend, we beseech you, and ye little ones learn godliness. Did Peter by any means at that time understand the secret of that discourse of the Lord? Not yet he understood, but that good were the words which he understood not. Godly he believed. Therefore, if hard is a discourse, and not yet is understood, be it hard to an ungodly man, but to thee be it by godliness softened. For whenever it is solved, it both will become for thee oil, and even unto the bones it will penetrate. 24. Furthermore, just as Peter, after their having been scandalized by the hardness, as they thought of the discourse of the Lord, even then said, The word of life eternal thou hast, to whom shall we go? So he hath added, verse 22, Cast upon the Lord thy care, and he shall himself nourish thee up. A little one thou art, not yet thou understandest the secret things of words. Perchance from thee the bread is hidden, and as yet with milk thou must be fed. Be not angry with the breasts, they will make thee fit for the table, for which now little fitted thou art. Behold, by the division of heretics many hard things have been softened. His discourses that were hard have been softened above oil, and they are themselves darts. They have armed men preaching the gospel, and the very discourses are aimed at the breast of every one that heareth. By men instant in season and out of season, by those discourses, by those words, as though by arrows, hearts of men unto the love of peace are smitten. Hard they were, and soft they have been made. Being softened, they have not lost their virtue, but into darts have been converted. His discourses have been softened above oil, and themselves, the softened discourses, themselves are darts. But thou not yet perchance art fitted to be armed with these darts, and not yet for thee shall hath shown that which in discourse perchance is obscure and hard. Cast upon the Lord thy care, and himself shall nourish thee up. Upon the Lord cast thyself. Behold, thou wilt cast thyself upon the Lord. Let no one put himself in the place of the Lord. Cast upon the Lord thy care. See in what manner that great soldier of Christ would not that upon himself the care of little ones should be cast. Hath by any means Paul for you been crucified, or in the name of Paul have ye been baptized? What did he say to them after that? Cast upon the Lord your care, and himself shall nourish you up. But now a little one would cast his care upon the Lord, and some one or other meeteth him, and saith, I will take thee in. He meeteth as it were a ship tossed by the waves, and he saith, I will take her in. Do thou also make answer, a harbor I seek, not a rock. Cast upon the Lord thy care, and himself shall nourish thee up. And see, a harbor doth take thee in. He shall not give for everlasting tossing to the just man. Thou art seeming to toss in that sea, but a harbor taketh thee in. Do thou only, before that thou enter into the harbor, break not away from the anchor. The ship is tossing at anchor, but not afar from the land is she driven, nor for everlasting will she toss, even if for a time she toss. For to tossing belong the words above, I have been made sad in my exercise, and have been troubled. I was looking for him that should make me safe from weakness of mind and tempest. Tossing he speaketh, but not for everlasting he shall toss. For to an anchor he is bound, the anchor is his hope. He shall not give for everlasting tossing to the just man. 25. But to the others what? Verse 23. But thou, O God, shalt bring them down unto the pit of corruption. The pit of corruption is the darkness of sinking under. Thou shalt bring them down, he saith, unto the pit of corruption. Because when blind leadeth blind, they both fall into a ditch. God bringeth them down into the pit of corruption, not because he is the author of their own guilt, but because he himself is the judge of their iniquities. For God hath delivered them unto the desires of their heart. For they have loved darkness and not light. They have loved blindness and not seeing. For behold, the Lord Jesus hath shone out to the whole world. Let them sing in unity with the whole world. For there is not one that can hide himself from the heat of him. But they passing over from the whole to a part, from the body to a wound, from life to a limb cut off, shall meet with what but going into the pit of corruption? 26. Men of bloods and of deceitfulness. Men of bloods, because of slayings he calleth them. And oh, that they were corporal and not spiritual slayings! For blood from the flesh going forth is seen and shuddered at. Who seeth the blood of the heart in a man rebaptized? Those deaths require other eyes. Although even about these visible deaths, circumcilliones armed everywhere remain not quiet. And if of these visible deaths we think, there are men of bloods. Give heed to the armed man, whether he is a man of peace and not of blood. If at least a club only he were to carry, well, but he carrieth a sling, carrieth an axe, carrieth stones, carrieth lances, and carrying these weapons, wherever they may, they scour, for the blood of innocent men they thirst. Therefore, even with regard to these visible deaths, there are men of bloods. But even of them, let us say, of that such deaths alone they perpetrated, and souls they slew not. Those that are men of bloods and of deceit, let them not suppose that we thus wrongly understand men of bloods, of them that kill souls. They themselves of their Maximianists have so understood it. For when they condemn them, in the very sentence of their council they have set down these words, "Swift are the feet of them to shed the blood of the proclaimers. Tribulation and calamity are in the ways of them, and the way of peace they have not known." This of the Maximianists they have said. But I ask of them, when we have the Maximianists shed the body's blood, not because they too would not shed, if there were so great a multitude as could shed, but because of the fear in their minority, rather they have suffered somewhat from others, then have themselves at any time done any such thing. Therefore I question the Donatists, and say, in thy counsel thou hast set down of the Maximianists, swift are the feet of them to shed blood. Show me one of whom the Maximianists have hurt so much as a finger. What other thing to me is he to answer than that which I say? They that have separated themselves from unity, and who slay souls by leading astray, spiritually, not carnally, do shed blood. Very well thou hast expounded, but in thy exposition acknowledge their own deeds. Men of bloods and of deceitfulness. In guile is deceitfulness, in dissimulation, in seduction. What therefore of these very men that have been divided because of the anger of his countenance? They are themselves men of bloods and of deceit. 27. But of them he saith what? They shall not have their days. What is they shall not have their days? They shall not make progress as much as they think. Within the time which they expect they shall perish. For he is that partridge, whereof hath been said, in the half of his days they shall leave him, and in his last days he shall be an unwise one. They make progress, but for a time. For what saith the apostle? But evil men and seducers shall make progress for the course, for the worse, themselves erring, and other men into error driving. But a blind man leading a blind man, together into a ditch they fall. Deservedly they fall into the pit of corruption. What therefore saith he? They shall make progress for the worse, now however for long. For a little before he hath said, but further they shall not make progress, that is, shall not have their days. Let the apostle proceed and tell wherefore, for the madness of them shall be manifest to all men, as also was that of the others. Men of bloods and of deceit shall not have their days. But I and thee will hope, O Lord. But deservedly they shall not have their days, because in man they have hoped. But I from days temporal have reached unto day eternal. Wherefore? Because in thee I have hoped, O Lord. End of Psalm 55, Part 3.
Psalm 56 of Expositions on the Book of Psalms, Volume 3. Expositions on the Book of Psalms, Volume 3, by Saint Augustine of Hippo. Psalm 56, Part 1. A Discourse to the People of Carthage. Just as when we are going to enter into any house, we look on the title to see whose it is and whom it belongeth, lest perchance, inopportunely, we burst into a place whereunto we ought not. And again, in order that we may not, through timidity, withdraw from that which we ought to enter, as if in a word we were to read, these estates belong to such an one or to such an one, so on the lintel of this psalm we have inscribed, at the end for the people that from holy men will put afar off, to David himself, at the inscription of the title, when the Alophili held him in Gath. Let us therefore take knowledge of the people that from holy men were put afar off at the inscription of the title, for this doth belong to that of David, whom now ye know how to understand spiritually. For there is here commended to our notice no other than he of whom hath been said, the end of the law is Christ, for righteousness to every man believing. Therefore, When thou hearest at the end, unto Christ give heed, lest tarrying in the way thou arrive not at the end. For whatever that place is, where beneath thou shalt have stood, before that thou shalt have come home unto Christ, the divine discourse saith to thee nothing but, draw near, not yet is the place where there is security. There is one place where a most sure standing ground is established. There is a rock whereon a house doth stand up, so secure as that it feareth not the rain of the tempest. For the floods have beat against that house, and it hath not fallen, for it had been founded upon a rock. But the rock was Christ. Under the name of David, Christ is figured, because of him hath been said, he that hath been made of the seed of David after the flesh. Who are then the people that from holy men were put afar off at the inscription of the title? Let the title itself declare to us that people. For there was written a certain title at the passion of the Lord, when the Lord was crucified. There was in that place a title inscribed in Hebrew, in Greek, and in Latin, the King of the Jews, in three tongues, as though by three witnesses the title was confirmed, because in the mouth of two or three witnesses shall stand every word. When the Jews had read this title, they were indignant, and they said to Pilate, write not, King of the Jews, but that he said himself that he was King of the Jews. Write thou that he said himself, they said, not that the thing was which he said, but because in another psalm it is truly said, for the inscription of the title corrupt thou not. Pilate answered, what I have written, I have written, as though he were saying, I corrupt not truth, even if you love falsehood. Because therefore, in that cursed one, the Jews had indignation, saying, we have no king but Caesar alone. From offense at that title, they were put afar off from holy men. Let them draw near to holy men, and cleave unto the Holy One that confess and desire to have Christ for king. Be they put afar off from holy men that gainsaying the title repudiated God for king, and chose man for king. Every people, therefore, that with human kingdom is pleased, rejecting the Lord from being king over them, to whom reigning every man is subject in such sort that he too may himself reign over his passions, every such people, I say, is put afar off from holy men. Do not, therefore, brethren, in the Jews alone, remark this thing. There were given in them, as it were, primitive examples, to the end that in that same people might shine forth that thing whereof every man should beware. There is indeed also a Caesar, a human king, for men in things human, but another king there is for things divine. One king for life temporal, another king for life eternal. One king earthly, another king heavenly. King earthly under king heavenly over all things. It is not therefore because they said they had Caesar for king that they sinned, but because Christ for king they would not have. And now many men Christ for king, in heaven sitting, and everywhere reigning, will not have. And these are they that trouble us. Against such men this psalm strengtheneth us. For it must needs be that such men we suffer even unto the end, whom we should not suffer unless for us it were expedient. For every temptation is probation, and the effect of every probation hath its fruit, because a man, for the most part, even to his own self is unknown, what he may bear, or what he may not bear, he knoweth not, and sometimes presumeth that he may bear that which he is not able, and sometimes despaireth of himself to be able to bear that which he is able. There cometh up a temptation like a sort of inquisition, and a man is found out.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.